1932. The Great Depression grips the world. Times are worse than tough. They're desperate. Many men are out of work. But the country doesn't want for male heroes. Women suffer in different ways, and usually they suffer alone. There's almost only one escape, the movies. You pay your 25 cents, and you walk into a darkened theater. And for the first time, you see her. A shock of platinum hair, a body barely contained by her skin-tight gown. A bad girl who breaks all the rules. She is Jean Harlow.
Keep away from me, I'm warning you.
Why don't you do it?
Keep away from me!
You don't dare stay here. You don't trust yourself. Oh, do it again. I like it. Do it again.
In olden days, a glimpse of stocking was looked down as something shocking. Now, heaven knows, anything goes. Good authors, too, who once knew better words, now only used for letter words, writing prose, anything goes. The world has gone mad today, and good's bad today, and black's white today, and day's night today, when most guys today, the women prize today, are just silly gigolos. So though I'm not a great romancer, I'm sure that I'm bound to answer when you propose. Anything goes.
Hey, that hurts a little bit.
You don't like to be hurt, do you?
Well, I don't know. Kind of fun sometimes if it's having the right spirit.
Hello, I'm Sharon Stone. Harlow was a superstar at 19, a legend at 26. She played opposite the greatest stars of her time, Gable, Tracy, Powell, and Cagney. She combined sophisticated comic timing with a flawless naturalism. She made blue noses gasp, women grin, and men extremely hot beneath their collars. She embodied sex when the very word was seldom uttered in mixed company. She was, and still is, beloved by millions. And yet no star has been more misunderstood or had more lies written about her. She was accused of being as trampy as the role she played. But the truth is altogether different and much more surprising. Together we'll discover a woman who was at war with her screen persona, yet whose life and films became strangely interwoven. It's one of the most unexpected stories in Hollywood history. Amazingly, the notorious blonde bombshell came from a well-to-do, respectable background. She was a child of privilege, born Harlene Carpenter in 1911 in Kansas City, Missouri. Her mother's name was Jean Harlow. Mother Jean's father dealt in real estate, and Mother Jean was a force to be reckoned with.
My little baby, that's who you are. My little baby, you'll be a star.
Mother Jean was obsessed with her daughter. All her life, she would call Harlene the baby. In 1922, when Harlene was 11, Mother Jean divorced her husband, a mild-mannered dentist, and took the baby to Hollywood. After enrolling Jean in the Hollywood School for Girls, Mother Jean chased her dream of being a movie star. She did not get a single acting job and returned in defeat to Kansas City with her daughter. In 1926, mother and daughter each fell in love. Mother Jean was swept off her feet by Marino Bello, a dashing Italian with the smooth charm of a gigolo and no visible means of support. While Harlene fell in love with Charles Fremont McGrew II, a wealthy young playboy of 20. Most parents wouldn't approve of their 16-year-old daughter dropping out of high school to get married, but Chuck McGrew had social status and was about to come into a sizable fortune. For Mother Jean, it was too good a match for her daughter to pass up.
Don't you worry about me. Blondes never go broke.
It's no secret, honey. I've always had a man with money. Some people think it's kind of funny, but I just love a man.
Early in 1928, Harlene and her new husband moved back to California, where he bought a mansion in Beverly Hills. Her mother soon followed with Bello. The life of the idle rich bored Harlene. She was looking for something to do with her time. Soon, she found it. Harlene got her first film work on a dare. Some society friends bet her $250 that she didn't have the nerve to try out for a movie part. Taking the dare, she went to Central Casting. The name she gave them wasn't her own, but her mother's, Jean Harlow. Almost at once, the beautiful teenager was offered extra work. Harlene wasn't interested. Then Mother Jean found out. Still dazzled by her own former dreams of stardom, she pushed the baby into the movies. Harlene Carpenter was now Jean Harlow. Just 2 months after she started acting, Harlow was getting featured bit parts. This one with Laurel and Hardy seemed guaranteed to catch the public's attention. Chuck McGrew didn't want his wife to work at all, much less with her clothes off. If Harlow's career strained her marriage, Mother Jean's control of her daughter destroyed it. Harlow believed that Mother knew best. Forced to choose between her husband and her career, she sought a divorce at age 18.
I'm just an innocent girl!
Hey, wait a minute!
Where's the baby?
Hollywood's sex symbol of the silent era met the first sex symbol of the talkies in Saturday Night Kid. The film starred Clara Bow, the it girl of the 20s, and it featured Harlow's first speaking part.
Come on, kids. We've only got a half an hour before the curtain rings up.
Harlow's first lines on the screen were forgettable, but her next role would launch her to stardom. A rich young Texan named Howard Hughes had first shot Hell's Angels as a silent film. But in 1929, the talkies were causing a sensation. He wanted to convert Hell's Angels to a talkie. But its original leading lady, Greta Nissen, had a distinct Norwegian accent. Hughes searched in vain for 6 months to cast a part of an unknown. Finally, he shot a screen test of Jean Harlow. She was young, inexperienced, and would work cheap. For the lead female role in one of the most expensive film productions ever, Hughes paid Harlow only $100 a week. He also signed Harlow to a 5-year contract. It was the best investment he ever made. To showcase Harlow, Hughes decided to shoot this party scene using the 2-strip Technicolor process. To audiences accustomed only to black and white, the result was a sensation, and so was Jean Harlow.
There she is. Don't point, it's rude. Oh, Helen!
Roy!
Here was a star with a bold new look and an even bolder immorality. One who captured the broken spirit of an America sent reeling by the recent stock market crash.
How do you do?
How do you do?
And one who would redefine sex in cinema for once and forever.
May I have this next dance?
Of course.
She was 19 years old. This provocative scene did more than help make Harlow a star. It gave the world an unforgettable catchphrase.
Would you be shocked if I put on something more comfortable?
I'll try to survive.
Hell's Angels didn't just open, it exploded.
Hell's Angels, the opening of this picture at Rahman's Chinese Theater in Hollywood, was the biggest premiere ever seen anywhere in the world before or since. 500,000 people are lining the street. Jean Harlow.
Thank you. I would like to use this occasion to publicly thank Mr. Hughes for the opportunity he gave me.
You told me I fly like an angel.
Suddenly, Jean Harlow was one of the most recognizable women in the world. Her platinum blonde hair was her trademark. And until then, only tramps and floozies had bleached their hair. But now, nice women were peroxiding theirs like harlots. And Harlow. Her image was selling everything from cigarettes to soap. Howard Hughes owned Harlow's contract. To cash in on her overnight success, he pushed her into as many movies as possible. Hughes charged the studios thousands of dollars for her services, but paid Harlow only a few hundred dollars a week.
You must get paid pretty well when you work.
Oh, tremendous.
Harlow couldn't act yet, and she knew it.
Oh, my bashful boy.
After her next few performances...
You are different, Tommy.
Her audiences knew it, too.
Very different. And I've discovered it isn't only a difference in manner and outward appearances. It's a difference in basic character. The men I know, and I've known dozens of them.
After several embarrassing performances, Harlow was becoming a national joke. Maybe the platinum blonde was only fool's gold after all.
Trick's been coming kind of tough lately, huh?
Oh, I was all right until I got the flu.
Show business?
Movies. All the directors admired my talent. But you gotta be on the inside.
In 1931, the studios had the absolute power to make and break careers. And as far as they were concerned, Harlow was history. Assuming she was washed up, Harlow told her agent she planned to work in a store. It looked like Jean Harlow was going to be a has-been at 20. In 1931, the Great Depression had hit rock bottom. Millions were out of work. And though still under contract to Howard Hughes, Jean Harlow feared that she too would be unemployed. What happened next seemed like a Hollywood movie. Every actress in Hollywood knew that Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer had the power and prestige to make stars out of nobodies.
Meaning me?
Yes, you.
What do you do for a living?
Stenographer.
Working now?
No.
What do you do for a living if you're not working?
Look for work.
That's all. But listen, sister, you're not walking around this town without being watched, see? Keep your nose clean.
Paul Byrne was the most revered MGM producer on the lot. He had already helped start the careers of Greta Garbo, Norma Shearer, and Joan Crawford, the great leading ladies of the MGM lot. Byrne persuaded MGM to give Harlow a part in Beast of the City. Her performance was anything but prim and proper.
I don't mind taking orders, but there's one decision that's always up to me.
Come on, sit up like a lady. I know that trick.
Unintentional, mister. Say, do you think I'm so dumb as to pull a gag like that?
You might. You're built for it.
Despite Harlow's strong performance,